sets are designed to the T, to the last bit, and then they are executed in 10 days. So basically everything is made for the set.
What would the
pre-made?
Okay.
Designed and pre-made.
And then
you have to be very precise. In the they are like AutoCAD. We use AutoCAD. We use architectural programs to design the set.
Which was the most challenging that comes to mind?
They are all challenging in different ways, but I think the film, there was a film set in Goa, which is called the Bourne Supremacy, which we built four houses in South Goa, in Palolem. For that, the most challenging part of that set was the fact that the director had said that he wanted the, and the cinematographer had said that they wanted the walls to fly, so that they would be able to put a track and move in from the exterior space into the interior space on one track, which means the walls have to disappear. But normally when you shoot the walls disappearing, the roof is pulled up on the ceiling of a sound stage by ropes, so that the roof goes up, the walls get moved out, the house doesn't collapse. Here, the sky was the roof. So, we had to figure out a very smart way on how to fly the walls.
As well as, so
the roof didn't collapse. And so, we devised a method where basically the foundation was very deep. It was in the sand. But I made these columns of around on quite far sides with scaffolding rigs cladded with ply, to make the walls, and then so that a section of the wall could go out. And so it till say about 8 or 9 or 10 feet, and then the rest remained like a cross beam.
Okay. Now, you doing so much, you must be taking a lot of your time in the film world. How do you find time to do all this?
Well, this actually happened along the way. I worked a lot with artists who basically, all along the process, on every film, we were either painting shutters or signboards or in Darjeeling Limited, a train. And I worked a lot with signage and truck and wall artists constantly. And so it was, some of the work got made in the process of that time, actually.
Okay.
So, you know, the ideas are always coming and the work is always getting created at the same time. So it's not that this ends and that begins and that ends, and you know.
So there are projects flowing into one another kind of thing.
There are projects that are overlapping all the time. You work on, you shoot with various chairs and suddenly they are in a work that exists. Mm. And mainly also what they represent, you know, the gaddi or the everyman's chair.
Yes. Yes.
So
that's why I think you've called your exhibition Zindagi.
Yeah.
Why?
But it's life. It is about everyday. I mean, and it's about everyday life, and it's about many people's everyday lives. And so I think it's about your Zindagi, her Zindagi, his Zindagi. All of it is coming, you know, it's all unfolding through these objects that don't have people, but they have people for
that, me. Yes. I was going to ask you that. Do you think you'd move into portraits and things like that for people? Because most of your work at the moment are inanimate
objects.
Only
photography.
Through photography.
A little bit, but not a lot even in photography.
Okay.
Yeah. There are lots of objects there too.
Mom is writing another book.
Well,
yes?
It's actually not a new book. It's a collection of talks and speeches I've given, or memorial lectures. So what we're doing is taking the memorial part out of it and making them into articles and updating it, and then writing one or two new items, like say the Verma committee report about that, because that's what happened only a year ago.
Yes.
And one or two other essays. So we'll put it together and call, and then the author's note, of course. So then we call it Talking of Justice.
Wow.
So it should be interesting.
It has a lovely cover.
Yeah.
Are you
very
doing
nice.
It?
No, a fantastic designer called Bena Sareen, who works with
Aleph,
and we pass these things around the house. We send them for comment.
Yeah, from all the family.
Yes.
Yeah,
you know, we send them for comment through the family. Yeah. If anyone has any ideas about the font or the look or
So everybody's got some little input
yes,
into your book.
Yes, absolutely. That's nice. In any case, when I wrote my memoir, I had to send it to the family because there may be something that about their lives which they don't want said or they don't want. So we sent it around to everyone, and then everybody made their comments, and then only I.
When you wrote that, did you also land up stamping any feet around besides not the family? I'm saying, but. You must have ruffled
well,
feathers.
Well, certainly some.
Yeah, because being in the position that you were,
certainly some.
You probably did.
Certainly.
But no regrets, I'm sure.
No, not at all. I feel that you've got to be straightforward and honest, otherwise there's no point in writing a memoir. If you're not going to tell the truth and tell the unpleasant things or the people who've done things which you don't think are right, you must mention it, you know. Mm-hmm. They may be the Chief Justice of India or they may be somebody else, but you have to talk about it. Yeah.
You know, we were just chatting a little earlier, Mum and I were talking about how things have been in the past and gradually getting worse. And Mum said that probably every generation feels that the next generation needs a kind of a vision, a kind of some saving. How do you view it?
Yeah, I think as well that we are getting, as a nation, less ethical, greedier, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong with consumerism, but the way that it's being kind of eaten, you know, and I think one of the things that is that somehow we have a lack of leadership, of really fantastic leaders.
Sincere leadership.
Really great leaders, you know, and I don't think we have a huge number of fantastic thinkers, but we don't have a lot of leaders or people in position that I feel are really working for and with the people, and that's the idea of being in politics.
Isn't that sad for a country that has produced Mahatma Gandhi and to be
What do you think? Don't you think that there's a lack of leadership?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No, there are a lot of leaders, but as you rightly said, lack
leadership.
Of leadership. Yeah, it is all more internally driven, selfish.
Yes.
And that's why we've landed in the position that we are.
And it's now been regarded as okay. You know, there was a time, I think, when people weren't comfortable in the idea of the idea of corruption the way it is today.
Yes, yes.
Slowly people have eased into the idea that it's okay.
It's okay, yeah. As long as your job is done.
You can privatize water, you can make it difficult for people to have something which is a basic need, a basic natural resource, and then make money off it, you know, as politicians. It's quite sad.
That is indeed, yeah. And education also, they've removed certain things like I think moral science and stuff like that, and we've got something called value education brought in which doesn't really teach them values. Earlier we used to have, you made a mistake and you got punished for it, now you can't punish. So things are becoming more and more difficult in that respect as well. Yeah. But as an artist, how would you, like if you were to leave a message for our people in Goa, what would you tell them? Is it a difficult route to take, or go ahead, break a leg and do it all the same?
You know, I'm not so good at giving messages. I feel like people have to figure it out for themselves on what they feel is correct or, you know, in the way that they are oriented. I mean, I feel very lucky because I spend a lot of time in Goa.
Yes.
And I really enjoy the privilege, really, of space and time here,
yes.
Which I didn't so much earlier. So I mean, I know that it's changed a lot from
it
before. But in fact, when you come from outside, it feels like it's still very special. You still.
Yes.
There is still the morning quiet and
not as noisy as most of the other places.
Yeah.
Yes.
To wake up to paddy field is quite fantastic.
Amazing. And you, ma'am, a message for our youth.
Message is always difficult, but I would say one thing, you know, people all are always criticizing. They have to start doing things themselves. They have to become the leaders. That's the thing. Indeed. And there used to be an Oriental proverb, which was very nice, which somebody who was 80 years old used to always quote. She said, never curse the darkness, light one candle. So, I mean, however dark it is, we light one candle, and everybody lights their candle, there will be light. Indeed. So, the leaders are, you don't need to have one leader, you may have many leaders now. That may be the new way of looking at things, you know. Yes. So, I would say, never do nothing. Do things.
Do something.
Everybody
does it through their own medium.
A little bit, we get a better tomorrow.
Yeah, and whatever you do, do it with honesty and integrity. You know, do it well. That's the integrity. If a postman is friendly and posts his letters properly and doesn't throw them away, you know, every simple, single job is done properly and with, you know, integrity, then there would be no problem at all.
Yes, it isn't an ideal world. I mean,
but people have to start doing that. They have to become the leaders or at least have that honesty to do it. And so that's what I would say. Go ahead.
Well, it has been a pleasure, and I would love to have continued this, but we run out of time. So thank you once again for being with us, and wish you a pleasant rest of your stay in Goa.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for being with us, and we look forward to having you on our next episode of Gazali. Till then, keep watching Prudent.